she laid him in a manger, he was still her little child. In a city filled with strangers, he was still her little child. Though the inn was full and the night was cold, she held him close and smiled. When she laid him in a manger, he was still her little child. When the angels called him Savior, he was still her little child. When the wise men gave him treasures, he was still her little child. When the shepherds bowed before him, a star shone all around. When the angels called him Savior, he was still her little child. When he grew in strength and wisdom, he was still her.
Kathy, for being back there and getting all this going. But just appreciate all the things that people do around here. Lois, don't you love the sign outside? I think that's so wonderful. I love all the things that she does around here. I was talking to a friend this week, and we talked about the kids that I used to teach and what they have developed into now. Unfortunately, I'm not overly pleased with all of them. But that's really contributing and brings me to how I came about the message today of sharing with us about holiness today, and how we learn to hear the voice of God, or in some cases not hear the voice of God, and why. For instance, God doesn't speak to us out of our experience. Our experience is a great way for us to mark our path, to know where God has been leading us, so that we can look back and see where we've been and maybe might see where we're going. But our experience is not how God speaks to us. Another, for instance, is I taught children for about 9 years in the fifth and sixth grade and helped Sue Ann in the nursery. Then I taught preschool with Sue Ann for another 9 or 10 years. And I've been teaching in Vacation Bible School since 1996. But around 2003, I started teaching adults. And I've been doing that ever since. So if I believe that God was speaking to me out of my experience, then I would only be working with children. Which isn't a bad thing, but my point is God does not speak to us out of our experience, but our experience does mark the path that God has been leading us along, and we can look back and see what God has been doing through our lives. Today, I want us to look at a few of the many verses in the Bible about being holy in our lives. They're up on the screen for us today. There's 7 passages. Let me share those with you. I'll read them with you. But like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. We actually missed the first one, I think.
Yes.
For I am the Lord who brought you up from the land of Egypt to be your God. Thus you shall be holy, for I am holy. Okay? Go back to Psalms. How blessed are those whose way is blameless, whose walk in the law of the Lord. How blessed are those who observe his testimonies, who seek him with all their heart. They also do no unrighteousness. They walk in his ways. Again, please. In Romans, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lust, and do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not be master over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. In Ephesians, just as he chose us in before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him. Go ahead. For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them. But he disciplines us for our good so that we may share his holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble, and make straight paths for your feet, and so that the limb which is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Pursue peace with all men, and the sanctification without which no one will see the Lord. Go ahead. In our last one, let the one who does wrong still do wrong, and the one who is filthy still be filthy. And let the one who is righteous still practice righteousness, and the one who is holy keep himself holy. There are many, many verses about holiness, but those give you a direction of why we're talking about this. Because I've said to you before, there's no magic formula about hearing God's voice, because God primarily speaks to us from the Bible and during our prayers with him. Therefore, it's not offensive to him to stop praying or reading your Bible when you believe or understand that God is speaking to you or directing you to do something in a particular way. I'm asking you, I'm saying to you, please pursue what you're understanding God to be telling you to do. Stop what you're doing. Pursue that. But my main point will be that there are obstacles to our living a holy life. As I've said, if God has to spend time correcting you for whatever, then you won't be experiencing Him fully, and you might not even be hearing from Him. Let me share two common obstacles that stand in our way of living a holy life. Language and hateful thinking are primary obstacles to our ability to live holy lives. It affects us all the time. Now, you may not have a lot of hateful thoughts until that person cuts you off. You may not have a lot of hateful thoughts till you see something on TV about how evil somebody has been. Or you may not have a lot of hateful thoughts till you hear some politicians promising stuff and then never doing them. It happens. We're mortal. That's who we are. And frankly, wonderful if you don't have bad language in your repertoire. Wonderful if you don't have hateful thinking or hatred in your repertoire or in your reservoir, as I'm going to be talking about it. That'll help a lot in our deal. But here's the point. When I say my reservoir, that's the stuff of who I am. That's all of me. And when we have hateful thoughts sitting down in this reservoir, eventually they are going to pop up. Eventually they are going to come out, maybe at the wrong time, and embarrass us. Now, Paul liked to use athletic examples, so let me use athletics since we're in the middle of Olympics right now. These ice skaters that we're watching, the skiers, really all of them for the most part, have been getting up about 4 a.m. in the morning and going out to practice before school when they were young children. They had to eat a certain way. They couldn't be out with other children. Instead, they practiced what? Over and over again. They disciplined themselves and went further than most of us are willing to go. Dwight's daughter had a world standing at one time. I'm sure she came home crying on many occasions because she had a pulled and sore muscles and she iced them down and iced this and that down. And then guess what happened the next morning? She got up, went back to school, and then practiced that afternoon. We are children of God. We are covered by the blood of Jesus. We are ransomed from the pit of hell and sanctified and justified and sealed unto the day of redemption. We are made righteous by all of that process that I just named. And there's a name for that in the sanctification word. It talks about our holiness. So in all of the things that I've just described, we are positionally sanctified in our holiness in Jesus. But listen, we are progressively sanctified based on our right living with God. Or should I say right living for God, and how we work out our salvation unto our holiness. You with me? That's our responsibility, to progressively be sanctified in our right living. What we do and how we live, and what we do with how we live, are all a part of that progressive sanctification that is our responsibility to discipline ourselves. And that's why I complain over and over about Hollywood. I was watching Sci-Fi Network, Paul, the other night, and now Sci-Fi is allowing all the filthy words to be used. There just seems to be no regard for family lifestyle or protecting the general public from filthy language. Hollywood and those who have authority over our airwaves seem to have collectively become very permissive in allowing filthy language and vulgar language and behavior on a public forum. I was watching Ghost, that new show, Ghost, the other night, and they were openly talking about sex and talking about slang words for the arousal of humans on a family show during family viewing time. What would you have done, Kathy, if you were sitting there watching this comedy and all of a sudden they start coming out with these slang words about arousal and Ashton sitting there?
Oh, no, it wouldn't happen.
It would have happened because you wouldn't have known it was coming.
Yeah,
but right there it was. So I'm complaining. What I'm complaining about is that it seems to be harder these days. We have to work harder these days to keep the filthiness of the world away from us, because, quite honestly, it's easy to succumb to. Or perhaps we have those old habits that we have put away from us, but we've never emptied them out of our reservoir. They're still in there somewhere, and I promise you they're going to show up. So my point that I'm trying to follow through with here is that holiness is actually our responsibility, and we are the ones that have to discipline ourselves to not let the worldly ways infect us in our common lifestyle, because it's always in front of us. The world stuff is always bombarding us. So we have to work and discipline ourselves to put it away from us. Matter of fact, I would even say it this way. Holiness is a Christian lifestyle that we have to discipline ourselves to live by. And in that Christian lifestyle, how are we using that for God to show up in our lives? How are we using holiness in our lives for God to show up in? There's a common phrase out there. It's to whom much is given, much is required. In the near future, we will finish this, our New Testament study on Wednesday nights, and we're going to begin looking at spiritual gifts. And I have a survey that I'm going to hand out for you to take home. And you're going to look at that, and you're going to examine that. And you may have one or two spiritual gifts that God has given you to use for His glory. Or maybe some of you may find that you have three or four spiritual gifts. But what about the person who has several spiritual gifts? How are they using those grants from God to show up in their lives? And quite honestly, if they're not using them, I'm persuaded that the Lord will take it away from them. But how are you using your spiritual gifts to bring glory to God and His church? That's why we have spiritual gifts, to bring glory to God and build up His church. So we're going to properly understand how to identify spiritual gifts. I'm a connoisseur of chocolate. I know you can't tell that. But, you know, what if that means, if I were to perceive, okay, that means that God wants me to be a baker, and maybe I need to stand out on the street corner and hand out chocolate, which I'm sure would be a pretty happy thing for most people. But that would be a misinterpretation of a spiritual gift, wouldn't it? Instead, when I retired, I asked God to give me a moldable and sweet heart, which tells you that I probably didn't have one before. But I did that, and guess what? God began to build up in me mercy. So that's a spiritual gift. Mercy is. So we're going to learn how to identify those. And there are many things that we're going to be talking about. But all of this involves how we manifest our holiness. How we take these spiritual gifts and use them in our lives to glorify God and build up His church. How do we put those things in our lives to honor God and do all of those things for His glory? For instance, Paul and Susan and Kathy and Nancy are here on Sundays to create an environment for us to worship in. But guess what? Nobody can make us worship. Worship occurs when we have developed a prepared heart. If you walk in here without preparing your heart, you may do church, but I don't know that you're going to be able to worship. What if, that's one of the reasons why we sing first. It allows our spirits to soar. It builds us up. It lets us enjoy the presence of the Holy Spirit with us. And then we open up the Word of God and enjoy it together. We have to let our spirits soar. But if you've had a bad week, maybe you've been angry all week. Maybe some stuff is happening at work. Maybe you've just been a little off for a while. But you've shown up to church because that's your practice and you're a good Baptist. But somehow or another, you're just not able to worship today. You know what? The Word of God opens up to our hearts and minds. So we have to spend time praying. We have to spend time reading, because life happens. It's okay. It's okay that you have difficulty worshiping. Just go back Rebuild yourself. Pray, ask. Guess what? If you've been sick all week, you're really not in a great place to worship. But the Word of God builds us up. It teaches us holiness. It teaches us the understanding. It teaches us to get rid of the stuff out of our reservoir and cast it away from us. Because then it won't be there for us to draw upon accidentally. We just have to rediscipline ourselves, get back in that right relationship with God. Okay, I'm going to have a short sermon with you today. So listen to me carefully as I make these last points. Holiness has an aspect of purity in it. Purity means that a person or an object is not tainted by the elements around it. A diamond, for instance, is worth more according to its purity and its color. Here's a real example. Who wants to eat food that has been tainted? Who wants to drink a glass of milk that's been left out since yesterday? Who wants to drink water? Have you ever turned on the faucet and rusty water came out? Did you just fill your glass up and gulp that down? Nobody wants to do that. Nobody wants to do that. They purify our gold and our silver before we put our wedding bands on. Kathy's been teaching about James, and we've studied about James on Zoom. And you know, James teaches about practical lifestyle of faith. Faith without works is a dead faith. It is a major theme of James. So what I'm sharing with you this morning is that we want those things that are tainted in our lives to be removed out of our lives. To cast them away. Because it gives us a jaundiced eye. There in James, he talks about the fact that when poor people come into the church, they put them over here. And they say, you stay over there and you listen. But when the rich people come in, oh, come in here. Oh, here's a front row seat for you. That's what tainted thinking does. Or tainted thinking thinks it's okay to treat people in a bad way. Here's a word for you, godliness. Godliness is a major aspect of purity and holiness. James says that a tongue is a flame of fire that can set a forest on fire or ruin a relationship. Right? Therefore, the tongue has to be bridled in order to exhibit holiness in our lives. That's what I'm sharing with you today. Things can taint our thinking. It can get left down in our reservoir. But we eventually are going to draw it out. Think it's the next one. Eventually we'll draw it out and it'll come. Sometimes it'll pop out at the most embarrassing time. How can we avoid that? By getting rid of the tainted parts of our lives. How do we do that? By continuing to discipline ourselves under the authority of God and His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Every one of us has the Spirit of God living in us, so we are to let the Spirit of God loose in our lives. Now, what do I mean by that? You know what? There are people in the churches today, not necessarily in here, but in churches today, that have the Holy Spirit all boxed up nice and neat, so that they are very good about coming into church on Sundays, having a great time on Sunday, and walking out on Monday and doing whatever they want to, or going to wherever tonight, and being in a place that they shouldn't be in. I always marvel when I drive down trying to think what I guess it's Mockingbird. And these adult videos places. And the place is crowded in the middle of COVID. I'm always amazed at what people get out of that. But if a person has the Holy Spirit all boxed up neatly in their life, they've got everything compartmentalized, then they can do whatever they want to. That's what I'm talking about. That life is tainted. The Holy Spirit needs to be freed to control every area of our life, to control our thinking, our speech, and all the other areas of our life. And when we do that, what do you think might happen with such an audacious response by letting the Holy Spirit free in our lives? This is what I believe will happen. When you read the Bible, when you pray, when you attend church in person or virtually, if that's what you need to, then God can speak to you without having to spend time correcting you. And then you can hear that precious voice. You can feel the nudge. I've told you before, not always do you hear God's voice. It's that nudge. You know that you have to do it. You know that you have to be that, be a part of that. Or you know that you have to go do something. Or God has brought that person up into your mind that you need to be praying for. And when you talk to that person, you'll know it's just the right time. I did that last week with a young lady. She's in college somewhere. And she said, you know what? The Lord told me to be praying for you as well. Like, you know what? I needed that. What a sweet response that I got from her. Now, folks, we're not going to be pursuing this series a whole lot longer. So when I'm sharing these things with you, I'm encouraging you to use these things to get and stay in a close love relationship with the Lord, that you can hear His voice, that you can know that nudge, that you will recognize it. Because it's not always the same. How many times did God speak out of a burning bush? One. How many times did God speak in a voice when somebody has their face all covered up? One time. How many times did God pass in front of you? Probably not ever, but He's done it once to somebody. You see what I mean?
Amen.
So, we're here for hopefully 70-something or 80-something. Do you know Margie's going to be 90 next month? We're here for a certain amount of time, but listen, we're going to spend all of eternity forever with God. But our actions here do affect our hereafter there. Okay? Remember that. I want to get to as close to Hallelujah Square as possible. And I want you to also. I want to be there with my family. Amen? Let's pray and we'll have the Lord's Supper. Gracious Father, we love You. You are incredible. You are merciful. You're kind. You're forgiving. You're understanding. And yet You are a holy God that cannot tolerate sin. And so, Father, I just pray that what You do in our lives brings glory to Yourself, glory to Your name. And whatever You would do, that You would use our lives to bring that glory. And allow us the privilege and the joy of it. In Jesus' name.